fixed up and they're modernized. And about the only time you find something which is not being modernized, in Java at least, is when you have Wakaf, Wakaf donation, the mosque built on it. And then there have been doubts in people's mind as to whether they should do anything about it, because it's a gift of the original donor. It's not supposed to change it, it's supposed to adapt it. So sometimes you find a mosque that is falling down because it was Wakaf, and people felt they shouldn't interfere with it. But otherwise, these are living institutions, so people change them, of course. They develop them, they repair them. And therefore, archaeologically, they're very difficult.
There have been some really interesting archaeological work with Claret, where they're digging out parts of the old mosque that, you know, if they ever get the funds to finish it, should be really interesting. Tell them the platform of the mosque, or what's now the ground level, is probably 4 or 5 feet above the sort of what the ground level should be. And even the prayer mission, things like that, that they have found, are a good 7-8 feet below the surface. So, you know, if that excavation materializes, we may actually have some, you know, some significant things.
Maybe we should take a break now. So we'll take a break for 10 minutes. Please don't be longer than 15.
We're reduced to a hard core here. People really want to hear all this stuff. I must say, I haven't looked at this material for a long time. It's actually nice to go back to it, to figure out what we know. Just remind you where we got to. We got the impression of Islam spreading first in Sumatra, in Trengganu, Central Java, Brunei, so kind of west to east movement, with most of the early evidence suggesting that the main trade routes were where things happened, with, for example, Islam spreading in Maluku, before it spreads in places like Madura or Timor and so forth. So the impression that by the early 16th century from Tomei Village, where things stand, we know something about the content of the faith, which seems to be dominated by Sufism. So it's mostly Sufi Islam. But there's no real evidence yet of specific tariqa. But it does seem to be Sufi Islam. The big question is, why should anyone have adopted Islam at this stage? We can't be sure. I mean, trade seems to have a role. Without trade, you've got no information about Islam at all. But as I say, it seems to be the case that we have trade, and Muslim traders have been present for a long time before there's any significant local conversion. And even the material we have from the early 16th century suggests conversion was still, the earliest days of Islam, conversion was still going on in large parts of the archipelago. Now, I mentioned before that one of the things that strikes me is the way in which, in the Malay legends, you get these dramatic transitions to Islam, great magical events, boats coming, people with dreams, magical circumcision, and so on. We don't get any of those things in the Javanese legends. And that may tell us something. I mean, it's possible, it seems to me, that in Java, you've got a quite well-developed high culture, Hindu, Buddhist in origin, but which is in its religious sense is mystical. And it's not hard to imagine in that situation mystical Sufi teachers, perhaps people claiming magical powers, winning over converts in Java. Whereas in Sumatra, we have much less evidence of major states. There were major states, Sriwijaya, turned into Malacca, but in large parts of Sumatra, we don't know anything at all about the place until Islam comes. So maybe Islam in many of those places was a much greater transition because it would have brought literacy, and international connections, and holy book, and all the things which might be a major cultural transition in Malay-speaking areas than in Javanese-speaking areas. And before we abandon that theme, so one thing I've kind of thought I'll show you, which would to me suggest that something about those transitions in Java. Now, this is the Mosque of Demak. It's said to be the earliest mosque in Java. We don't know if that's true. It's usually dated 1470s, 1480s, something like that. But the first thing you notice, of course, is the tiered roof is a Javanese-style tiered roof. It's not Islamic, not a Middle Eastern tower roof. By the way, there's quite a big debate about where that architectural style came from. You can find mosques like that in India, in Kerala, but you can also find that there is the argument that really what happens in the case of the Javanese mosque is that you have a Chinese pagoda style and you put a sarangi on the front. Yeah. And that's what the Japanese sort of give, suggesting Chinese influence. This is inside the mosque, the pillars, including the sokotatal, which was said to